We are of God. He that knoweth God heareth us. He that is not of God heareth not us. For sin shall not have dominion over you. For ye are not under the law, but under grace. He that committeth sin is of the devil. For if ye live after the flesh, ye shall die. For to be carnally minded is death. Pass the time of your sojourning here in fear. It is a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. Wherefore, gird up the loins of your mind, because it is written, Be ye holy, for I am holy. But ye are not in the flesh, but in the spirit. Walk as children of God. Hereby know we the spirit of truth, and the spirit of error. That after ye have done the will of God, ye might receive the promise, receiving the end of your faith, even the salvation of your souls.
What we're going to show in this video is how the message that's being preached today is not bringing about any redemption or forgiveness of sins. This is really astounding when you break it down and compare it with what the Bible teaches. The Bible teaches a baptism of repentance. Now what this is the death of the gospel, a demise of the preaching of repentance. Of repentance is proven by deeds and a faith that works by love, as we've pointed out many times. Now the purpose of the gospel in the book of Acts, in Acts 28:18, it was just to open their eyes in order for them to turn from darkness to light, from the power of Satan to God, that they may receive forgiveness of sins. There it is. Now remember that. Forgiveness of sins and inheritance among those who are sanctified by faith in me. Acts 28:18. In Acts 26:20, I preached that they should repent and turn to God and prove their repentance by their deeds. Now this is not being preached whatsoever in the church today, and even in the evangelical circles of outreach and evangelism. Not at all. They try to get close to it. They try to talk a little bit about repentance, but they don't mean the same thing the Bible is talking about, the baptism of repentance. Now, I liken this when I was thinking about putting this together today, thinking about back when I first came into the church. See, I didn't get saved in a church. I didn't come to Christ in a church. I came to Christ through reading His Word through our families. And then we sought out a church and started from there. And as we went to these churches, we went in there and, of course, didn't know much at all about the Scriptures other than something radical had happened to us. So we started hearing this stuff preached. We started hearing these things, and it didn't sound quite right, and it didn't make a whole lot of sense that your sins were forgiven in advance, and God can't see you sinning, and Jesus suffered the wrath of God for you in your place, and I'm imputed righteous even though I remain sinful every day in thought, word, and deed. It just didn't add up to what happened in our crisis of conviction and in repentance. That we didn't, of course, didn't even know what to call it then. But I didn't question these things, mainly because the people that were saying them and speaking them seemed very knowledgeable and well studied. They were studied long. Many of them had went to school. Some of them even had doctor's degrees, all that kind of thing. And number two, I thought probably in my young spiritual state that they probably had proof texts that they would put me to shame if I challenged them. If I sat down and challenged what they were saying, well, show me this and show me that, and they probably had a proof text to show me something that I just clearly hadn't seen yet in the Scriptures. So I gave them then the benefit of the doubt that they were correct to some degree. And we stuck with it for years, and you went through the whole mess. But however, as we learned through the Spirit, these things became more and more clear to us. We began to see the fallacies behind imputed righteousness and eternal security and all the, and God can't see you sinning and your future sins forgiven. We began to see that this stuff really didn't have a leg to stand on. And now I can stand here, as we've done in our 50 or 60 videos on Google, trying to help out the people that are seeking the Lord. And I can tell you confidently that almost everything these guys throughout my past, and probably yours too, these teachers have been saying, is the exact opposite of what the Bible really says. The exact opposite. And we're going to show you that here in repentance and faith. again, we've shown this before, but we're going to show it in a little bit different dynamic here. So I can tell you with confidence, even though if you're not well learned, you're not well studied yet, you still don't have a sharp sense of discernment at this time because you just recently came through that crisis of conviction and that repentance. But you know that through the witness of the Spirit that you've came to God. Therefore, you know because He's witnessed it to you that you are. Your sins are forgiven, and you do have that new man abiding in you, but you don't quite have a grasp on all these spirit of error yet. Remember, faith is the victory that overcomes the world, the flesh, and the devil. I point that all out all the time. And remember, what that means, overcoming the flesh and the devil, means overcoming the spirit of error, the strong delusion that's in the church today. And believe me, this is strong delusion, the stuff these guys are preaching. So I found out then that the Bible nowhere teaches that the righteousness of Christ is imputed to you by faith. It doesn't say that anywhere. You can say, you can say that confidently to anyone that would confront you about it. The Bible does not say any text anywhere in the Scriptures that the righteousness of Jesus Christ is imputed to you by faith. Only by conjecture. They give it by conjecture in 2 Corinthians 5 and Romans chapter 5 and different other places. But it doesn't say it. It says your faith is imputed to you as righteousness, but not Christ. There's a big difference. And nowhere does it imply or say anything by conjecture that your future sins are already forgiven, that your past, present, and future sins are forgiven in Christ. Not by conjecture, not by the fact that He died 2,000 years ago on the cross, and that covered the sins of mankind. That's extending it way too far. That extends it beyond logic to say your sins are already forgiven and that God no longer holds you accountable for your continued sins. Those things are not in the Scriptures, folks. Not whatsoever, okay? You can say that with confidence.